From June 22nd to June 24th, 2007, professional wrestler Kriss Benoit committed a double murder-suicide that scratched the heads of hundreds of people directly involved. On that Sunday, 15,000 fans at the Toyota Arena in Houston, Texas were left perplexed upon the entry of John Morrison taking on the iconic CM Punk for the vacant ECW title.
It's either going to be CM Punk or Johnny Nitro, who came to ECW from Raw in the supplemental draft.
This bewilderment was due to their reasonable expectations on the ECW feud between CM Punk and one of the greatest technical wrestlers of all time, Kriss Benoit. See, that night, Kriss Benoit wasn't in that arena, nor was he in Texas. He was at home, dead at 40. As this video progresses, I will provide more data and details on this grim tale as I try to unravel this entanglement within my own mind. But I sit here at my desk asking me the question, what do I want to achieve with this video? I'm not doing this for publicity's sakes, I'm doing this for myself and the others that were heavily affected by this incident. Me and many other people of my peers were watching wrestling during this sudden shift. In 2007, I was so shocked that I chose to deny Benoit's actions, almost as if he was just framed. After doing a lot of research and studying the actual cause and effect of this matter, I finally realized the reality of this situation. For this video, I'm going to assess Kriss Benoit's final matches before he committed these acts. As the homo sapien I am, I'm going to try to develop a buffer of understanding that will help not only provide closure to myself, but many others. In addition, I will be debunking many conspiracy theories on the matter. I will explain by the end that yes, Benoit did do it, and there are reasons for it. But he was no spawn of evil, he was a man in pain that whimsically lost all the control he once had. I hope you guys enjoy the video. I worked real hard on this one. April 20th, 2007. Kriss Benoit, at this point, was the US champion, which he obtained from Booker T at No Way Out. This match was during the WWE tour across Europe. Benoit is allying with the Hardys, going against Chavo Guerrero, Gregory Helms, and MVP. Upon entering the ring, Benoit looks kind of like Benoit, I mean, a subtle straight face backed with an aura of intimidation and power. As the bell sounds, Benoit and Chavo start the match. Benoit's wrestling style is founded with Japanese technical attributes. Benoit usually starts his matches with grappling, Irish whips, and submissions. Benoit also likes to use chops and tackles. MVP and Benoit were going through a feud during this period, so it kind of explains why Benoit was acting aggressive in his combat against MVP. Benoit jumps off the turnbuckle for the flying headbutt that resulted in a non-head-based impact. This match kinda shouldn't count because it was rather short. It is kind of a good way to introduce Benoit. Seeing Benoit in his final stages of life really puts me in a daunting state. He kind of resembles an individual that looks exhausted, but nothing I would consider off-putting. I mean, I'm not a psychiatrist. I don't have the knowledge to truly detest Benoit's symptoms with those of sociopaths. However, I am found to be a very passionate wrestling fan. Watching this match, I see no differences between this and other great performances. This match lacked a lot of action from Benoit. At this point, I realize my ignorance. I realize that in order for me to understand, I need to do more research and put a little bit more detail into my notes. This isn't going to be a biography of Benoit, but rather a reference to where he learned the ropes of his combat. Kriss Benoit's wrestling career started in 1985 for Stampede Wrestling. With the inspiration of Thomas Billington, also known as the Dynamite Kid, Kriss Benoit learned a lot of his iconic moves such as the Snap Suplex and the Diving Headbutt. Ironically, Benoit's nickname was the Crippler. This nickname was given to him after a 1994 ECW match. Benoit and his opponent Sabu botched a back body drop that resulted in Sabu landing on his neck and breaking upon impact. Thus, the name was coined. Many superstars have said that Benoit has a very reserved, kind heart.
I never knew he had all those concussions. I didn't know he had that. You know, like Kriss was Kriss since the day I met him. He was a bit of a loner at times, but no, there was no signs of that.
Like everybody was saying it had to be that. I didn't want to believe it. I didn't want to believe somebody I knew for 16 years and liked, you know, considered a friend. Could be that much of, could turn into that. Because I truly believe that he turned into that, that he was not always that person.
April 29th, 2007. Now let's talk about the second to last pay-per-view Benoit ever performed in, Backlash 2007. He was taking on Montel Vontavious Porter, MVP as mentioned before. His gimmick was that he was one of the highest paid free agents, cause for some reason that matters. Upon the entrance of Benoit was the reasoning for me taking the risk of starting this project. This Benoit was not like the first match. This man didn't seem happy. Nevertheless, my emotions at this point were just sugar-coated opinions, so I chose to just shrug it off. But I hope my sources that appear further on will provide understanding to my feelings. Benoit enters the ring slowly. He gloats about his belt. Then they begin the match with a grapple. The grapple gets pushed to the corner, then goes back to another grapple. MVP tries to go for the legs, but Benoit takes control. A sudden crossface to another grapple that flips Benoit to the mat. Knees to the spine to more submissions, and Benoit goes for a sharpshooter in the center of the ring. MVP grabs the ropes. MVP gives a kick to the back of Benoit's head. Michael Cole mentions a list of matches the wrestler competed in. This has nothing to do with Benoit, but it's a side note for how predictable Michael Cole's commentary is, and it's probably a reason why people don't like him. Triple German suplex with Benoit taunting. He goes for a crossface, but fails. Benoit then does 5 German suplexes, which then gets taken to the turnbuckle, which is then countered into a leg lock, which then Benoit goes for the crossface again. He misses, but then wins with a sudden roll-up. All in all, this match was okay. Nothing scary or unorthodox.
About a week before the events transpired, Chris Benoit, I was on AOL, Chris Benoit tinkled in with an instant message. Hi, Bill. Oh, hi. How come you're not working for WWE? Do you want me to talk to somebody? I said, no, I've had some offers, et cetera, et cetera. He said, well, I'm sitting here with Daniel on my lap. We just wanted to say hello.
There is absolutely no medical evidence out there that would tie my son's behavior at that time of the tragedy to steroids. They keep talking in the press. Medical experts say that this is drugs and steroids. It's so far from the truth.
Upon watching the Chris Benoit matches, my researcher and I were looking up sources, and we discovered this entry on change.org. And I know there's a chance that this was sparked by an irony memer. I'm more referring to the comments themselves, but wait a second. I'm trying to think with rationale here. I'm talking about the internet. I'm pretty sure more people are going to sign these chain.orgs, and then eventually WWE will have to sign Benoit into the Hall of Fame again. In addition, I discovered this Reddit article claiming 10 statements that complemented this claim that Benoit was innocent. These claims baffle me. In 2007, I was 10. I knew wrestling was fake, but this real-life event really made me think differently. I was in denial that Chris Benoit was a murderer. I embraced these theories as concrete fact. I mean, I was 10. Benoit was innocent in my prepubescent mind. I can't prove whether or not the original poster was serious, but what I can prove is why it's wrong. Now let me explain. Chavo Guerrero, a close friend of Benoit, told WWE Magazine that he talked to Chris for a while on Friday night on his house phone. About 45 minutes into the conversation, Chris told him that there was somebody knocking at the door, and he was going to see who it was. Shortly after Chris answered the door, there was a scuffle, and then his house phone line went dead. Chris could only be reached on his cell phone about 3 hours later. This is very significant, because this explains why there was no forced entry. Chris let the killer or killers in.
There is no record of Chavo ever saying this in a WWE magazine interview. You can go back through the archives yourself at wwebackissues.com.
There is a 45-minute documentary made by Wrestling Pundit that goes into detail on the conspiracy theories and explains why they are all wrong. It's a 45-minute video, and I highly recommend it. It's very well done, and it's worth checking out in my Project Benoit playlist. Would you actually believe that a 260-pound physically fit man with testosterone levels higher than average was murdered in a home invasion? Who also, mind, was murdered on Sunday? And his kid was murdered on Saturday, and his wife was murdered on Friday. So it was a home invasion, you're saying? and Benoit was innocent. Okay.
In fact, the company made it their policy not to even mention Benoit publicly after it was determined that he was responsible.
And this was true. As a matter of fact, the following actions were taken by the WWE to limit Benoit's appearances. Benoit's name was removed from his previous theme song, Rabid, from the WWE Anthology album. I used to own this album, actually. Benoit and his moves were removed from SmackDown vs. Raw 2008. WWE's DVD releases removed him as much as possible, as well as having any commentary of him cut. On the contrary, the WWE Network, which I'm watching off of, will display just a parental advisor warning before the program airs. You just can't see the Benoit tribute show, because that would be a bad idea. Benoit's theme song, Whatever, performed by Our Lady Peace, was never played by the band ever since the tragedy occurred. After Chavo reached Chris on his cell phone, Chris is misspelled by the way, he said that Chris sounded very odd, groggy, and tired. He also said that Chris told him, "I love you, Chavo," which sounded forced. The WWE also said that when Chris called in and told them that Mansi and Daniel were sick, he did not sound like himself, he sounded groggy. Chris then said, "I love you," which they say was out of context because he never really said this.
And he's like, "Oh, call right back. Hey, Chavo, hey, what's up, man?" He sounds just off. I'm like, "Man, you okay?" He's like, "Yeah, I'm cool, man. Just really bad. A really, really just bad weekend. I just, you know, Daniel and Nancy are sick, his wife, you know, and, you know."
So you're actually talking to him at this point.
I'm talking to him, yeah. And this
is basically after he's probably killed his wife.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. They're sick, you know, they're not feeling good. And I'm like, all right, cool. And will you come? He gets off getting ready to get off the phone. And he goes, he makes a point of it. It stops. He goes, Chavo. I go, "Yeah." And he goes, "I love you." I said, "I love you too, man." Wasn't too odd, you know, off kilter, because mm-hmm. we always tell each other we love each other.
Yeah.
But this was really forced. It was not forced. It was really like made a point of it. It was like, "Hey, man, okay, I love you, brother." Okay. No, it was like, "Chavo, I love you.
I want you to understand this."
Basically. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
Don't forget this.
Coming from a man with very few words.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was like, "All right, I love you too, bro." So I hung up and I thought, that was strange.
Chris's cell phone was missing. The police cannot find his cell phone or the needles they say Chris used to inject himself with steroids shortly before he died. The police have turned his cell phone off. Okay, so let me tell you something. So steroids was not found in his body. He has taken steroids in the past. They only found testosterone in his blood. Also, why does the cell phone play such a key role in this case? Chris was not hanging from the weight machine. He was lying on the floor underneath the machine. Another officer said that Benoit was slumped against the weight machine. Alright, so I'm gonna have to pull up a source from Fox News. I know it's Fox News, but hey, listen. The evidence found that he hung himself from a pulley machine on Sunday. I was refraining from mentioning this, but
I really don't know. I can't say whether or not that was his plan all weekend. I know that in the search engine on the computer that he had researched the quickest and easiest way to break a neck.
Really?
Yeah.
Chris had the intention to commit suicide. It was very obvious. There was a white cloth wrapped around Chris's neck. If he was so suicidal, why would he care if his neck was bruised? Sort of an idea. He used the cloth so he could gain more leverage, putting more force lifting the weights as his neck was being wrapped around in wire. The cloth around his neck was probably most likely a result of gravity, if this claim was even true, as it's not even backed by a source. The medical examiner says that Chris Benoit died on Saturday. The text messages were sent on Sunday. Chris was already dead, so who sent the text messages? Chris Benoit died on Sunday. When the case first came out, there was so many different people saying so many different things. There was a lot of disorganization within the case. Some people were saying that Chris Benoit died on one day. Others were saying Chris Benoit died on another. Some were saying that he was taking steroids. Actually, some sources even said that he did the crossface on his own son, which is very blasphemous, and it's just the media trying to stab Wrestling Corporation. I'm not quite done yet with this dude's post, but I promise you, I'm not gonna go through all 22 reasons, because it's just a waste of time in this video.
I mean, I spend 15, 20 minutes talking to these guys, encouraging them. You know, I'll stand up and take my shirt off and say, "Look, it can be done. You know, believe in yourself, because that's what it's about. And it's like, I there's a lot of champions that I never got that from, you know, throughout my years. And I looked at that and I thought, no, that's not right. That's not what being a champion's about.
The same world that pushed you into the depths of darkness to start with.
Yeah. The world doesn't push you into the depths of darkness. You do. And it drives me nuts because the week before WrestleMania, there's a big article in USA Today talking about Dale Wilkes, the Patriot, Raven was in there. 200 pills a day habit. And, you know, 200 pills a day. I had neck surgery, all right? I'm laying in the hospital the day after, and I'm taking no more than 4 pain pills a day. 200 pills a day? No, that's a little extreme, okay? And they blame it on the industry? No, it's your choice, all right? I've been doing this 18 years. I do it now. I do it every week. You know, I think I got a pretty good grasp, and I think I'm not an outsider looking in. So that's all BS, complete BS. It's your choice. It's your decision. And that, you know, the media love to take something like that and run with it. And it's not the world of wrestling drove them to alcohol or the world of wrestling drove them to drugs. No, you do that to yourself.
May 20th, 2007. MVP fought Benoit for the United States Championship at WrestleMania 23. And as we just saw, he lost the title to him at Backlash. Now, they were duking it again at Judgment Day. This time in a 2-out-of-3 falls match. MVP enters first, followed by Benoit. Here is the face that Benoit portrays. I gave my feelings on this already, now tell me yours. Jump in the discussion port below. Match begins in a grapple. Both go outside the ring and synchronizingly back in together. MVP slaps Benoit. Benoit slaps him back. They grapple. So one of the things the commentators mentioned was that the last episode of SmackDown, Finlay attacked Benoit's leg, therefore MVP is making that his target of destruction. Benoit tries to go for a crossface. Rope break. MVP kicks leg. Back to a grapple. MVP headlock. Benoit slaps MVP and takes control. Leg takedown. MVP goes for the leg. Targets the knee. Benoit does chops. 3 German suplexes. Benoit's knee gives out. Crossface. Rope break. Cycle repeats. MVP goes for the legs. Sharpshooter attempt. Rope break. MVP goes for the legs. Benoit counters. MVP goes for the leg. Benoit attempts the electric chair, probably by accident. MVP gets playmaker. MVP takes the first fall. So there's like a 60-minute break period. At this point, you could tell that Benoit's legs are giving out. Benoit takes control. Benoit catches the ropes. Benoit's leg gives out again. Crowd shouts, "This is boring." MVP tries a submission. Benoit crawls to the ropes. Rope break. MVP playmaker. Sloppy counter, which goes to a crossface attempt. MVP recovers with elbow to the knee. MVP rolls up and wins the second fall. 2 falls in a row. So this match was very lackluster. Mind that this match was after Edge and Batista for the World Heavyweight Championship. This match should have been longer and much more intense, but alas, this match had to be cut short because Benoit really hurt his knee. My point is this. Benoit is strong both physically and mentally. He's an individual that is phenomenal at hiding the pain he is in, and this match shows this to me dearly. He is very strong at taking as much pain as possible just to spread out the match as long as possible. As my research continues, I still see individuals that is defending the Chris Benoit conspiracies. To be clear, it is true that we may never know what exactly happened, but here are some key facts that many people must be aware of in this matter.
But he's the most influential person that I've ever met in my life because of the comeback that he has made within himself and with around his life, within the people in his life. I mean, it's amazing. I mean, he's put everything back together. He's very...
The death of Eddie Guerrero. Eddie Guerrero passed away suddenly on November 13th, 2005 at the age of 38. Benoit and Eddie were best friends that grew up together. The cause of death was cardiovascular disease. In 1999, Eddie Guerrero suffered from severe drug addiction after his car accident that almost killed him. Eddie took pride in himself to get clean, and he did, but the damage he did to his body was permanent all the way to his death, and hours before he was set to air on an episode of Raw. Many, including his nephew Chavo Guerrero and Chris Benoit, were heavily affected by such an incident.
He was the one friend that I had that I could go to and pour my heart out to if I was going through something, if I had a personal issue or a personal problem. He was the one guy that I could call and talk to, and he would talk me out of it, you know, because of all the experiences that he'd been through. We never left each other without telling each other that we loved each other. And I truly can say that I love Eddie Guerrero. I know that you're in a better place, and I know that you're looking down on me right now. And I only know that I love you. I miss you. Eddie, you made such a great impression on my life, and I want to thank you for everything you've ever given me. And I want to thank you from my heart and tell you that I love you and I'll never forget you. And now we'll see each other again. I love you, Eddie.
This was November 14th, 2005. To me, this was the day Benoit truly died. The Toxicology Reports. On July 17th, 2007, WWE released a public announcement on their website in regards to Benoit's toxicology reports. It indicates that he did test positive for testosterone and negative for anabolic steroids. Chris Benoit's last drug test was in April of 2007 by a third party known as Aegelius Labs. He tested negative for both. The fact that whether or not testosterone is linked to these acts is not 100% clear, as some people say that testosterone isn't linked to rage as much as anabolic steroids are. But this, of course, is highly debatable. Dr. Gerly Weidler of New York, a researcher of the use of drugs in sports, claims this act as in, well, he actually made this word up, so he basically says that it wasn't an act of rage. But this source was released on July 3rd, 2007. There was so many more details on this case that were released since then. Heck, the Talk is Jericho podcast. That came out almost a couple years after. Number 3. CTE. On September 5th, 2005, Chief of Neurosurgeon Julian Bailey's conducted a conference on the results of Benoit's post-mortem brain. Examinations discovered an unknown factor in the Benoit case.
And this is a healthy brain on the left, and you see a very smooth background here. You see normal brain cells and no abnormal staining at all. Very, very consistent. Here we see a very small section of Chris's brain. And you see these brown areas here against a very, very striking brown background here. And all of this area is staining for damaged brain cells. These are dead brain cells in their connection.
There was evidence of CTE caused by repeated trauma to the head sustained during Chris Benoit's career. We have now confirmed multiple concussions as part of his medical history, along with clinical symptoms associated with chronic traumatic enthalepy. CTE occurs in contact sports when the individual suffers from constant concussions, whether mild or severe. These concussions, when not healed properly, can cause permanent damage to the individual. Dr. Omalu claims that Mr. Benoit's brain had a brain that resembled an 85-year-old with Alzheimer's, which would lead one to ponder how Mr. Benoit would found his way to his airport, let alone be able to remember all the moves and information that required to perform in the ring. Paranoia.
This is an open letter to Eddie on November 24th, 2005.
The first entry, the first note to Eddie, was written on November 23rd, 10 days after his 38-year-old friend dropped dead of a heart attack.
Oh, Eddie, I forgot to tell you about my dream last night. I dreamt that both my parents were taken, perished. And Nancy and I were trying to get to her parents in Daytona to save them, because we felt that they were being taken next. And these people after them were very powerful people, high-ranking people. When we got to Daytona, it was too late. Her parents were gone too, perished. We just didn't understand this was going on at that time in Chris's life.
Chris Benoit also showed symptoms of paranoia that were presented in many of these fan theories. The source of the paranoia came from Benoit's father, when Benoit was taking alternative routes to get home, taking more turns than another, you know, making sure that no one was following him. To summarize, it was not performance enhancement drugs that killed Benoit, as it did to Eddie Guerrero. It was CTE from the constant headshots Benoit would take. Benoit's signature move, the flying headbutt, is literally him landing on his head. Watching these old Benoit matches revealed that he constantly took shots to the head whimsically, without any regard to the actual harm he was doing. It was all for the pop.
It's possible that if he'd stopped soon enough and had rested his brain at an appropriate time, that he could have recovered.
We had talked in terms about him retiring, and they had offered him positions within the company, but he had said to me at the time, "Dad, they're paying me so much money, why would I retire? I'm doing something that I love to do. Why would I quit?"
A suicide note was not discovered during the initial investigation, but a note was found in another Bible that had been included in Benoit's possessions that were sent to his first wife. Kriss Benoit's father, Michael Benoit, found a handwritten note that stated, "I'm prepared to leave this earth." As I said earlier, Benoit was a very strong human being. He didn't want others to see him as weak or frail from something that was just all in his head. From my experiences with depression, it taught me that it's common for people with depression to hide their depression from the outside world. With the combination of CTE, depression, and a sudden use of testosterone, these all probably played a role in the psychology of Kriss Benoit. This information will never give the understanding of what actually happened in the Benoit household. However, it does appear to me that Benoit did commit these acts out of a state of delirium and maybe depression as a result of crippling mental health.
I don't think there were so few people that knew Kriss. I think the only person that could answer that question is Eddie, and Eddie's not here.
June 5th, 2007. So wait, if Benoit was cleaned in April, then when did he take testosterone? To many people, this was a match of the century. Benoit was taking on the iconic rated R superstar Edge on Friday Night SmackDown. Edge is a phenomenal, superior, theatrical superstar that was currently a holder of the World Heavyweight Championship. Edge enters first, with Benoit following. Benoit looks a little out of it, and I'm not just saying that this time. Benoit stares at Edge, and the match begins with a grapple. Benoit pushes Edge to the corner that leads to another grapple, then to an arm drag. They both stare. Arm submission to counter, which leads to another grapple. Edge is frustrated. Benoit chops Edge to the ground with such force. Benoit drives knees. Submission? Benoit shows dominance. Edge pushes Benoit to corner, which leads to Benoit throwing Edge at full force. Benoit is playing very aggressive. Edge goes over the top, which leads to a commercial break. The match is back with a headlock, a very long headlock. Edge rakes Benoit, chops to outside the ring. Benoit drives legs into Edge from inside the ring. Pin attempt, kick out. Edge throws Benoit into the turnbuckle. Edge taunts, then a suplex. Benoit on the turnbuckle. Benoit repeatedly headbutts Edge to the point of being dazed. Benoit jumps off the top rope but misses. Edge dropkicks Benoit. Pinfall, kick out. Edge does work on Benoit's shoulder. Benoit gets up to feet and knees Edge once in the gut and next in the head. Both are down but get back up. With the help of an Irish whip, Benoit runs into Edge. Quintuple verticals in tribute to Eddie Guerrero. Benoit taunts. Benoit gets on the top turnbuckle. Flying headbutt. Pins. Edge kicks out. Benoit is upset. Edge attempts to spear, but lands into a crossface. Rope break. Edge spears Benoit, then wins the match. I am no scholar. I am not aware of the symptoms of high levels of testosterone in the human body. But I can say that out of physical observations I've made, this Benoit is much more different than the Benoit I've been seeing. I've noticed a pattern in Benoit's turbulent times. It seems to me that Benoit likes to repeatedly use the same techniques, which is fine in the sense of his fighting style. However, it just kind of feels like his performances are becoming more and more passive, almost as if like he's not completely there, he's just doing it because it's ingrained in his system. This theory of when the testosterone was administrated is still unknown to me, as the medical records are hard to find. And even if my theory wasn't true, it wouldn't matter. Benoit still did what he did.
People are so quick to say, "Oh, he's a murderer. You support a murderer. You protect a murderer." I don't protect him, but I don't think people really take into consideration mental illness. He was my friend and he was my mentor. And the guy that I knew wouldn't have done that. But I also remember lots of times when Kriss and I were in the ring and he would completely black out. He couldn't remember things. And it would happen all the time. I mean, I remember I spent time with him and his family, and I saw the love and I saw the interaction. So it's not like one day he said, you know what, I'm going to be a total prick and I'm going to do something ridiculous. Something happened that we don't completely understand.
June 11th, 2007. This was no episode of Raw. This was McMahon Appreciation Night. This was quite a night. Well, not really, but still. This was the tri-brand draft. A lot was at stake. The winner would receive a draft pick for that brand. Bobby Lashley representing ECW and Benoit representing SmackDown. The match begins with Lashley taking the legs of Benoit. Technical wrestling leads Lashley to slam Benoit. Benoit holds onto the arm. Benoit rolls, but Lashley grabs around Benoit's torso and they grapple once more. Lashley goes for the legs again and takes Benoit down. They are back up and then they grapple once again. Lashley lunges towards the legs with a slam. Benoit struggles to go for the arm, but Lashley rolls out of the way. Couple of knee shots and then a chop. Lashley counters with a very powerful slam. Benoit grabs Lashley and pushes him into the corner. Some kicks, some chops. A suplex with anger and more knee shots. Benoit gets a chop, but Lashley takes back control. Lashley, with full strength, picks up Benoit. Crossface attempt. Lashley manhandles Benoit once again. Amazing backbreaker. Benoit does some heavy chops. Lashley drives shoulder into Benoit. Benoit goes for the crossface. Rope break. Benoit then goes for the sharpshooter. It is broken, and then Lashley lifts Benoit. Benoit counters with German suplexes. Lashley drives Benoit into the corner. Benoit lifts legs and goes for another sharpshooter. Lashley breaks out of it. Lashley gets a final power slam and wins the match. See, Lashley, he's a very phenomenal performer. Seeing him pick up Benoit like a ragdoll is simply astounding. Lashley's performance was top of his class, and comparing it to Benoit's repetitive use of the chops and his three signature moves, you can see that this correspondence philosophizes the dejected feelings that were yet to come. I had fun with that one. I know that wrestling is staged, it's theater. However, it's the chemistry of the performance itself that I like to review, that I really enjoy about it. These individual wrestlers are unique individual people, and bits of their personality comes onto their character. Alright, so let me go back to that IGN post. If Chris had murdered his family, then why did he need to text people? Think about it. Everybody was dead. Nobody would hear him talking, so why text? Calling would have been so much easier. Alright. The point of this theory is to state that Benoit could have called instead of text the people he contacted. These texts were mentioned by Chavo Guerrero in the Talk is Jericho podcast. I delivered that source already. Chavo mentions that Benoit contacted him right around the time after he killed his wife.
That was strange. So I call him right back. And I go, hey man, are you alright? I'm fine, man. Like I said, I just had a real hard weekend, you know, and just, you know, I had to go to take him, you know, Daniel and Nancy to the hospital. And I'm like, oh, okay, man. Well, I'm here. Okay, man. Okay, cool. So then hung up. And that was the last I actually talked to him.
And he didn't say this just to Chavo. He was saying it to the talent agent of WWE Corp. All right, so let me explain this. Benoit had that need to text people because he was already at that breaking point, and he did not have the strength to call someone for any help. However, he still cared about the people he loved, and he wanted that to be clear. He was too ill to call his friends because of the stress level of committing murder was hitting him at that point. And once again, to believe that a 260-pound fueled testosterone was a victim of a home invasion is simply absurd and illogical whatsoever. Chris' body was badly decomposed, about the same as Nancy's. Like, this shows that he died sooner than Sunday, right?
You got that right. Oh my god, this one's really bad.
The toxicology confirmed that Chris had hydrocodone, a painkiller, and Xanax, an anti-anxiety drug. I've used both of these. These two drugs combined will sedate Chris and make him very sleepy, so he could not fight back. Benoit's toxicology reports did come out with him testing positive for hydrocodone and Xanax, but these were at therapeutic levels. The therapeutic levels of these two would have not been enough for Benoit to be completely sedated, especially when you're 234 pounds. So now, after reading all those completely absurd comments and claims on the matter,
also wanted to show you guys the bottom of the post when I saw this photo, and naturally that's where I stopped reading it and taking it seriously. This post was probably done by an ironic memer who just went too far by making 10-year-old me actually believe in its tomfoolery garbage. But also, you can see that the dude who ran it was pretty persistent on his beliefs, so I'm not exactly sure if he was serious or not. But perhaps I'm just upset in that regard that I just fell for it. Once again, I was 10. However, if you're going to make any conspiracy theory, have sources, have evidence, have logical reasoning back behind it. You can believe in conspiracy theories as long as those sources make sense. It's not like, you know, when people are saying that the Holocaust didn't happen. By the way, it did.
Well, we shared two rooms,
mm-hmm.
but we would watch Rock.
Oh, okay, so this is after the, after the show.
None of us were needed for Rock, because it was just a memorial show.
Right.
So we all went to the hotel.
And, oh, okay.
Like I said, we're just chilling in the hot tub and just relaxing. News keeps coming in. Now we turn on Raw, and it's still a memorial show, but now there's more news coming in about what's really happened. Don't think it happened.
Did anyone notice any changes in Chris's behavior?
No, not that I know of. And I rode with him twice, and he was, I don't know.
Do you ever hear Vince say anything after it all comes out that Chris did this?
No. Like, that's a crazy thing. It went from, we had a meeting about it, about what happened, mm-hmm. and then never talked about it again. But it never was told to us, hey, we're not going to talk about this anymore.
It just stopped.
You knew. Yeah. You knew we can't talk about this.
June 12th, 2007. Almost a day after Benoit was drafted, he was scheduled to wrestle that ECW, teaming up with CM Punk. This was a rather ironic period, as this was the arc in which Vince McMahon blew up in a limousine at the end of that episode of Raw we just watched. The segment begins with Benoit entering the ring. Here's a few shots of him. CM Punk then enters the ring. Benoit looks rather deteriorated. The match begins with CM Punk and Marcus Corvan. CM Punk tags Benoit. Benoit rushes for Elijah Burke. Fight goes outside the ring. Benoit takes control. Marcus enters the ring. Benoit continually chops and knees. Corvan corners Benoit, which then evolves into an Irish whip. Ends with a tag to CM Punk. Benoit is in the corner. So, I don't know, Benoit jabbers something at some point. The bell rings, and then Benoit is unleashed. Benoit inevitably does his usual, flying headbutt and sharpshooter. Benoit's theme then plays. At this point, I really don't know what to feel. Benoit looks rather on edge, but I'm still very flustered in my own feelings towards this case. Let's finish this so I can conclude my thoughts with the last appearance Benoit ever had on television. June 19th, 2007. At this point in time, Bobby Lashley was the ECW champion. However, Bobby Lashley was drafted to Raw, and the title was left vacant on ECW. Therefore, the vacant title needs a new champion. So anyway, this small tournament's gonna figure out who's the number one contenders are to win this title. Chris Benoit enters the ring. Here are a few new frames of it. Fatigue in Benoit's eyes. The bell rings. Grapple to start that leads to a takedown. Submission attempt. Technical wrestling. Crossface attempt. Elijah goes for a sudden pin. Benoit slaps Burke. Elijah Burke tries to do a roll-up. Benoit attempts the crossface. Benoit chops some more. Full force into the turnbuckle. Burke kicks Benoit's ribs. Goes for submission. Benoit struggles but turns inward. Benoit performs a Northern Light. Burke pushes Benoit outside of the ring, and Benoit lays there. Burke throws Chris back into the ring for a pinfall. Kicks out at one. Benoit takes control. Snap suplex. Knee and bridge suplex. Benoit does another triple German suplex. Benoit climbs the turnbuckle for a flying headbutt. Burke counters by lifting up his knees and hits Benoit in the skull. Benoit becomes very dazed. Burke tries to suplex, but Benoit sloppily attempts and succeeds a sharpshooter, and Benoit wins the slot. Fast forward to later that night. So CM Punk then wins his spot for the number one contender. Chris Benoit comes out. He walks into the ring and stares at CM Punk. They stare. Benoit goes for a handshake. They shake hands and just stare. This was the last public appearance of Chris Benoit on a WWE program. This hype was firmly set. Benoit was eager to get the title and achieve the opportunity to do so. The match between CM Punk and Benoit was the talk of the town at that time. I actually watched that episode of ECW and I was looking forward to see who was gonna win the vacant ECW title. And to think 3 days after this, Benoit commits the axe.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Last night on Monday Night Raw, the WWE presented a special tribute show, recognizing the career of Chris Benoit. However, now some 26 hours later, the facts of this horrific tragedy are now apparent. Therefore, other than my comments, there will be no mention of Mr. Benoit's name tonight. On the contrary, tonight's show will be dedicated to everyone who has been affected by this terrible incident. This evening marks the first step of the healing process. Tonight, WWE performers will do what they do better than anyone else in the world. Entertain you.
The conclusion. There's still so much that has been yet to be answered from this whole study. Besides a minor repetitive use of six moves and looking rather aged, Benoit showed very few warning signs in his performances. A man with such a damaged brain was still able to do the job that he did for over 15 years. It was fascinating. Honestly, there are so many guesses to what could have made him snap. Maybe that botched flying headbutt broke that single thread keeping Benoit together. Maybe his will to keep on performing sparked his interest in using testosterone. Or maybe Benoit was just lost in a never-ending state of thought that was never subsided even in this period of combat. What Benoit did, an act of rage or not, was a cry for help that went too far. This case was that of an untreated mental health patient. I'm not here to spread my theories of what actually happened. I'm here to conclude this detrimental case. Benoit went through a loss of momentary judgment that was fueled by his, well, we will never really know. Benoit was a very reserved man. He hid all of the emotions he was feeling. He wasn't hated. On the contrary, he was loved by many superstars that worked with him in the past.
He was one of the most loved guys in the business. And
he wanted to do what he loved, but he knew he couldn't do it forever. His body was naturally withering away. He pushed himself to the breaking point. He did that. The years of performance-enhancing drugs, constant concussions without healing periods, alcohol, depression from the loss of a friend, and the sheer ignorance of all of his problems were the factors of this downhill spiral. The Benoit case has done severe trauma to those affected by it, such as the Benoit family and kin, the WWE, and anyone that followed it on Fox News. Benoit may have left three people dead with no clear answer to dozens of the questions being debated, but it does shed light. It helps bring the realization of CTE to the WWE. It helps provide stricter steroid and performance rules. For those that detest the chair shot to the head being banned, maybe you should try taking a chair shot to the head and test me if you can handle that concussion feeling universally. In agreement with Kurt Angle, this is not the WWE's fault. It was wrong for WWE to make that tribute show too early without really knowing what actually happened. However, that does not ratify WWE as the source of the issue. WWE has complied as much as they can with the media and the authorities. WWE has never really made the best business decisions and is not necessarily the most trustful employer. It doesn't change the fact that, come on, Vince McMahon did an interview with NBC News when he was supposed to be dead. Chris Benoit was not a psychopath, but he did commit this terrible crime. He did commit this murder-suicide. He did kill his wife, he did kill his kid, and he killed himself. The whole point of this project is for me to explain that after watching half a dozen matches of Benoit, there was still no clear signs that he was a man that was about to commit murder. Sure, he looked fatigued and depressed, but he did not look like a killer. He looked like a tortured soul that didn't want his pain to leach out into the people that he influenced. With this being said, Chris Benoit should not be praised as one of the greatest wrestlers of all time, nor he shouldn't be wiped from the face of the earth. He should be seen as a victim of the many dark sides of the professional wrestling industry. I'm Uncle Unbated. Thank you for your time.
For several weeks, though, how can you so definitively say steroids played no part?
Well, we didn't say that. In essence, what we're...
That's a quote.
Well, I understand that our reaction, by the way, was to reacting to the hysteria of the media. Which quite naturally they want to get to the bottom of this as we do.
But Mr. McMahon, the quote is steroids were not and could not be related to the cause of death. That's very specific.
It's very specific, but it was relating to the word rage because of the steroid rage that everyone was using. And obviously this is not an act of rage, it's an act of deliberation when you do something like this over 3 days. It's not an act of rage, be it steroid rage or roid rage, whatever it's called, or any other rage. That's what we're referring to. There's no way, quite frankly, that we and or the media, it's all speculation until the toxicology reports come back. It's all speculation.
But because it's all speculation, I'm guessing, why were you so clear in saying you did not believe that steroids played a part? Steroids found in the house again. He has a history of violence by his own wife's account. And steroid use can also cause depression and paranoia, and that can also lead people to do crazy things. It doesn't have to be rage alone.
Right. I agree with that. There were any number of prescription medications as well found in the house, and whether or not they had anything to do with this behavior. Who knows? Or whether or not there were other aspects involved in his life that had something to do with this behavior. Hopefully we can find out in some way. This has been so devastating as a father and a grandfather and a father figure to all those associated with our brand. This is not what we're about. What we're about is putting smiles on people's faces. This is the opposite of what we do. We're entertainers. We entertain people all over the world, and we put smiles on faces. That's our job description, not something like this, to be tainted and smeared with this. It's no different than if you're a postal worker. You still use the post office, but obviously there's been problems there, too. There are problems everywhere. There was no indication whatsoever that this man could possibly turn into this monster and do what he did. And again, we want to know the answers just like everyone else. Steroids may or may not had something to do with this. Other prescription drugs, other pressures in terms of his son and his wife. I don't know, and some of this perhaps we'll never know. But hopefully we can put it to bed as best we possibly can and determine once we have real evidence in terms of the toxicology report.
Thanks for watching this video. I spent a lot of time working on this. Words cannot describe the amount of things I'm going through right now, but I'm doing the best I can to make sure I can still make some fucking videos. So stay tuned, because we have another season coming up after this.
Oh my god.